In this video, I'm going to answer the most common questions I get asked about my experience working in Africa as part of a returning member of the diaspora. Hey, what's up? My name is Aries and welcome to Diaspora Achievers. In this channel, I take the African diaspora on a journey to building businesses that contribute to the development of the continent, change the African narrative, and helps you achieve true freedom. So if you're new here and want to be part of this journey, here are your first two steps. Number one, click on the subscribe button below this video and click on the notification bell so that you never miss another video you need to build Africa. And number two, go ahead and get your own copy of the takeaway notes from the workshop we put together, where we invite diaspora entrepreneurs who walk us through and help us understand how to transition from corporate life as a professional diaspora to entrepreneurship in Africa or with Africa. Without further ado, let's get started. I was simply, networking, right? Using a skill set that we all have. So every time I was going back home on vacation, I was getting in touch with my friends who had moved back before me, who was working there, and trying to figure out, okay, what's life like, trying to talk to them and really get a sense for what would life, professional life was like. Because every time I was going on vacation, it was just on vacation, right? So I was always hanging out, keeping in touch with my folks. And one of my guys was basically asking me, hey, what'd you do? How's life going over there for you in Canada, etc. So he got to know about what I was doing. And a couple of days after that, he reached out to me and he said, hey, why don't you just come visit the office and I want to introduce you to somebody. And then, boom, he introduced me to that person. And then I told that person about what I was doing, showed them my resume, and then we left it as that. So, boom, vacation was done, moved back came back to Canada. Life was going on, everything was fine. And then all of a sudden, after 6, 7, or 9 months, I got a call, a random call, right? I see 337. I was like, oh, that's probably a family member. So I get a call, and then the person introduced themselves, and it was a hiring manager for the position who was basically saying, hey, I got this new resume, and I have a position for you. I wasn't expecting it, but sure. So we started talking and everything, and that's pretty much how I was aware of the position. I went through all the different rounds of interviews and all that good stuff, and I ended up getting the opportunity, the job. So to be honest with you, the reason why I left my comfortable life in Canada to take the position, probably two main reasons. One, at the time and still to today, Africa is hot. Everybody's talking about Africa. A lot of friends of mine, they had left the West and moved back to Cameroon. They had good positions. Every time I was going on vacation, life was good. So I was like, let's check it out, man. Why not? I have a good opportunity. The job is great. The company is great. And it's in my field, right? It's not like I have to do something different. I have to settle. So let's go ahead and check it out. To be honest with you, I didn't have like a strong, reason. It's something that came to my life. And I was like, let's go check it out. And it was a great job. So it would have probably been stupid of me not to accept it. And so that's a good question. I'm going to answer it two ways. Number one is, how much money did I need? And number two is, how much did I actually have in my pocket? So how much money did I need? I had no idea, right? Because every time I was going on vacation, it was simply and purely to visit, hang out with the family, party with friends, stuff like that. So I had no idea what rent was like, for example. I had no idea what bills were like and stuff like that. So as the conversation for the role got in serious, I started reaching out to my boys and my friends back home, and I started asking them, hey, how much is rent? What are the good areas to stay in? Yeah, all this question, how much, is it, for example, if you want to have a maid or somebody to help you cook or stuff like that. So obviously I was not going to cook, maybe not obviously, but I was not going to cook. So I was like, let me ask folks. So they started giving me information. But the one thing I made sure I did was to ask my fancy bougie friends how much they would spend on rent, how much they would spend for different categories in the budget. And I was asking my low-key friends too, right? So with that, I had a good sense of, what are the ranges in terms of rent and cost of living. Now it's up to me, depending on what I wanted to do, to make sure I know exactly how much is needed, right? And the second part of the question was that once I got that number, right, I knew exactly how much I would need for rent, how much I would need more or less for, let's just say, not accommodation, but a maid or whoever, how much I needed for my bills and stuff like that. Then I wanted to make sure I had at least 4 months of expenses covered when I took the plane to go down. So that's pretty much what I did. So when it came down to negotiating my salary, that was another area that was kind of tough for me because I didn't know what to expect or what to ask or what was or the rate. There was no Glassdoor or Monster.com or anything like that where I could go in and say, hey, for this kind of position, this is the number to expect. So I basically did the same thing. I reached out to a lot of folks that I knew. I already knew how much I needed to leave and how much I had an idea of how much I wanted to save, but I wasn't clear. But I just reached out to folks that I knew who had moved back in Cameroon and in different countries too, just to get a sense, okay, for this role in this company, how much should I expect to get, right? So, I asked me four, five, six folks. I did ask folks who had a much higher position, okay, how much should I sort of expect? And then in my negotiation with the hiring manager, I basically told them, hey, this is, first of all, I asked them, okay, what's the average number? They gave me a number, and I thought, they're probably trying to negotiate me down or whatever, but in reality, it was a good number. So, I used a little bit of leverage, right? Because I know they wanted me and they needed somebody like with my profile. And I basically, negotiated and got the number close to the number that I wanted. I was really happy with what it was. Oh, yeah, one more thing is I needed to make enough money to cover a portion of our mortgage here. Right, so when I left, I had my condo here, and I put it up for rent. I put it on Airbnb. Thing was fun, but in the back of my mind, I was always like, "Hey, what if it doesn't work out, or what if I can't find a long-term tenant? Then what happens?" So I still had that in the back of my mind that I need to keep a little bit of cash in case I need to cover my mortgage here, if ish happens. So was I treated any different because I came from abroad? From my perspective, to be honest with you, no. No. My colleagues, even my team members, they were good, they were great. There was no, I didn't feel any type of, sometimes they say, oh, because you come from abroad, they treat you funny. I did not feel that, right? And then to be honest with you too, I didn't really care. I didn't really look for that. Maybe I did, but I didn't pay attention to that. So the team that I was with, my guys, they were super cool. There was no complex or anything like that. My colleagues at my level, they were super cool. My bosses, I thought they were cool. I didn't see anything. If there was something, then I probably didn't see it or pay attention to it. Maybe I'm naive, but I don't want to pay attention to stuff like that. Sometimes there were jokes. I used to see like, hey, you did this and that, but it was all fun and games. It was never no hard feelings or anything like that. So I always joked about it too, right? I always jokes. I had jokes like, hey, if you guys don't do work, or if this sort of pisses me off, I'm gonna go back home, meaning I'm going back to Canada. But it was always a joke because I like to joke a lot and stuff like that. So yeah, I didn't think I was treated any different. In terms of competent, I thought they were all competent, to be honest with you. I mean, it's MTN, it's one of the top organizations across the continent. They do quite decent job at looking for talent, finding talent, and screening their talent. So my team, they were all good. I had no complaint in terms of competency. All the guys around me, they were good. So I didn't have any major concerns in terms of competency. I thought they were good. If there was a challenge, it was probably on the soft skill side because there was a little bit of a culture slide, yeah, kind of culture difference, if you will. But in terms of talent, I thought they were decent. What I like most about my entire term, so I stayed over for just under a year. What I liked most was definitely cost of living because it was cheap. I could afford stuff like having a maid to help me with cooking, cleaning, and all that stuff. Yeah, cost of living was cheap. We could travel in and out of the country, like in the region, so that was super cool. I could travel in the country and discover the country because every time I was going on vacation, I was just going to the main city, hanging out with my friends, either Yaoundé or Douala. Hanging out with my friends, hanging out with the family and partying with my friends, right? So we didn't even get to discover, visit the country. And then when I was there for that position, when I was working there, I was basically able to visit, you know, different places that I never heard or been to before. And I really enjoyed it. It was super cool to sort of get to know my country because I had never lived there, even as a student. I was not in Cameroon. So what did I dislike or hate it most? I would definitely say it was public transportation, man. Every time my car broke down or every time I had to take public transit, I just didn't like it, right? Because in Cameroon, one of the, if not the main transit system, if you will, not really transit, but really the cab, they basically go and stop and pick up everybody, right? It's not just like you get on your own and, well, you could do it actually, but I didn't do it as much. And especially during rush hour, like it's hard to find an empty cab. So you get on the cab and it stops, it gets everybody, people get in the car. Anyways, I just didn't like it. I didn't like that. And in general, I don't think I appreciated being in public customer service area, if that makes sense. Like going line up to go to the banks and line up to go to whatever service. I just didn't like it too much, right? So the most difficult situation I had to face at work was trying to figure out if a behavior needs to be changed or accepted because it's part of the culture. So I give you an example. If you call a meeting and in the meeting invite you say, okay, food's gonna be served or dinner or lunch, whatever it's gonna be served or breakfast, folks show up on time, you have a great meeting. Without that note, the attendance is not guaranteed, it's kind of whatever, right? So in the beginning, I was like, oh, I don't like it too much. But looking back, I was thinking, well, first of all, it happens here too, right? Maybe to a different extent, but it happens in the West as well. And the other thing I was thinking is, what if I go to Mumbai or Dubai or Latin America, right? And that's pretty much what it is if I'm new to the place and that's what happened. So I realized that in my mind, I was probably thinking, this is a behavior that needs to change because I'm not used to it in Toronto. But in reality, thinking back, if I were to move to Dubai or Mumbai, and that's what they're accustomed to, I probably would accept it and embrace it. So I think it was my fault, or it was up to me to really change my mindset and think, okay, you know what? What's the big deal? As long as people just show up and get to work and just need to, you know, work with it. Obviously, you can't have food delivered or served for every single meeting, but I still had to accept it and rock with it, if you will. So usually after I tell my story, folks ask me, okay, since everything was great, you like your job, you had good relationship with your teammates and then everybody else, why would you leave? Officially, the reason is that I was told I was not good enough, right? And officially, I was told that my boss had a different agenda, right? So I won't get into the specifics of it, but it was really nasty towards the end. It was really, really bad. So the one thing that I did not like personally about it was that looking at it from the perspective of the hiring manager, they hired me, they chased me in Toronto, kept on calling me and said, hey, we want you to start, you're a good fit and all that good stuff. So I left everything up here and moved, right? And when the relationship got sour, when it came down to part ways, I thought to myself, these guys are really doing this. But imagine I had no opportunity to travel back and come back to Canada. What would I have done, right? I would have left Canada, left a great life, a great job, comfortable, everything to go, and then boom, I'm supposedly not good, and then I'm left on the street. So I didn't like appreciate that. At a human level, I didn't really appreciate that, right? And on top of it, for what I was doing, for my skill set and my experience, there's no more than two or three companies that one understand what I do and two can afford me, right? So even if I would have looked for another gig down there, it would have been tough to find a company that understand what I do, that can afford me and that need me, right? Because you can have the first two, but they may not have a need to get somebody new. So that was the one thing that I was a bit bitter about towards the end. I was like, yo, you're gonna almost mess up somebody's life like that. But it's all good. I always knew that only you can take care of yourself. Nobody can take care of yourself better than yourself. So always be loyal to yourself over being loyal to the company. At least that's my philosophy. Yes, I will go back for sure in a heartbeat. But the difference is that with that experience, I know how to go back. For example, there were so many great opportunities, business-wise, in terms of entrepreneurship and all that stuff. I couldn't really look at it, one, because I had an agreement with a company. There's certain stuff that I could look into. Two, I didn't have time. I get into the office around 8, 9 in the morning, and I leave around 7, 8, or whatever the case may be. So I'm in the office every day. So I didn't have time to explore any other opportunity. And the other thing, too, is now everything that I'm going to be doing is going to be from a business entrepreneurship standpoint, because that's really where there are a lot of opportunities. So after that, when I returned back, I think the next year or something, I started investing in agriculture, right? So I started a farm and all that stuff. That's probably a different topic for another day, but I got into it and there's so many opportunities. So yes, I'll definitely go back. Okay, so hopefully I've answered most of the questions that usually get asked. If you have a question that you want to ask about moving back to Africa, finding a job, performing well at the job, cultural differences, anything like that. Now, if you just debated, you're not sure if you should leave your grad lab, just hit me up. Just put your question in the comment below, and I'll be happy to answer any question you might have, but to the best of my ability, considering my experience.